So there are a set of articles waiting for you for the analysis of the current affairs dated on 13th August 2019. So let me list out the articles which we are going to complete today. In Manasarovar, Chinese government lend a helping hand to Indian pilgrims. And the next article is about the Vikram Sarabhai, who was the father of Indian space program. And climate change, we have a report saying that July 2019 has broken the record of hottest month ever. And next, forest and tree cover in India. It's about 24.49% of India's geographical area is covered with the forests and trees, according to the report submitted in the parliament. Next, Supreme Court regional benches. It is the Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiah Naidu, has advocated the setting up of Supreme Court regional benches in Delhi North, Hyderabad or Chennai South, most probably Chennai, Kolkata in the East and Mumbai in the West. And it is the Nehru Boat Trophy Boat Race annually conducted by the Kerala State Government. So about this boat race, I'll be explaining you in this article. Next importantly, it is the nematodes, which is very important because it is responsible for the formation of 19% of ammonia of the soil. So I'll be explaining you about the significance and the composition of nematodes. According to the report submitted by the, according to the first global analysis of nematodes report. Next, it is OBC subcategorization mission commission. That is, this commission has been set up with the approval of President of India under Article 340 in order to identify the groups which comes under the central OBC list. So I'll be explaining you the details of this. And next, it is Preconception and Prenatal Diagnostic Techniques Act 1994. It is PCPND Act 1994. It is very important act because it played a crucial role in stopping the female fetuside deaths. Fetuside deaths and determination of sex before the conception. In this perspective, this act played a dominant role, and I'll be explaining the features of this act and the result out of the implementation of this act. So these are the set of articles, and the first article is regarding in Manasarovar, Chinese lend a helping hand to Indian pilgrims. So basically about the current dynamics of this Manasarovar, current news, the Chinese government took an initiative to improve the material comforts for pilgrims so that they can trek the high altitude, that is called Kailas Manasarovar, which is the Hindu holy site in Tibet. So going into the facilities provided by the East Chinese government under this current decision, the facilities are reception centers, each with about 150 beds, and rooms with charging points, common kitchen, common washrooms, and providing food for the yatris. So these are the facilities provided by the Chinese government. And this Kailash Manasarovar Yatra will be undertaken by two routes. That is, first route is about the Lipu Lake Pass in Uttarakhand, which is a very mountainous area. And next it is the Nathula Pass in Sikkim. So basically there is a note point to be concerned over here is this yatra involves the route that crosses territorial boundaries of India, Nepal and China. So the route which we have discussed earlier about the Lipu Lake Pass in Uttarakhand or Nathula Pass in Sikkim, it involves the cross-territorial boundary of India, Nepal and China. That is the important point to be noted over in this concept. And coming to the importance of this yatra in improving the India-China relations, first one, it promotes people-to-people exchange, and second one, it strengthens friendship and cooperation between the two countries, India and China. Basically, this yatra is organized by the government of Delhi, Uttarakhand and Sikkim, and also the government of China is also included, with the cooperation of Indo-Tibetan border police. So, and the logistical support for the and facilities for pilgrims in this yatra are provided by the Uttarakhand's organization called Kuman Mandal Vikas Nigam and Sikkim organization called Tourism Development Corporation. So these are the institutions which organize this Manasarovar Yatra. So this is about the Manasarovar Yatra. Coming to the next important article is about the Vikram Sarabhai. So we are going to discuss about his 100th birth anniversary. It is the Google which celebrated the 100th birth anniversary of Vikram Sarabhai with a doodle. You can see the doodle over here. This is the doodle. Okay. And coming to the fact sheet, profile of Vikram Sarabhai. He was born in Ahmedabad in 1919 and he received doctorate at Cambridge University. And he was the founder of Physical Research Laboratory in Ahmedabad in 1947. And basically he is considered as the father of India space program, where he asserted the Indian government on the need for India, a developing country, to have its own space program. So this is the rationality why we call him as the father of India space program. And he also established the Indian National Committee for Space Research in 1962, which later we renamed it as ISRO. And his other contributions are, it is the Tumba Equatorial Rocket Launching Station in Thiruvananthapuram, and it is also the first satellite Aryabhatta. He has given exceptional services, and by the time this Aryabhatta was launched, it was 4 years after his death. Means he did not saw its launch. Next, and the other institution founded by him are, that is IIM, that is Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad, Community Science Center, and Darpan Academy for Performing Arts, in which this Darpan Academy for Performing Arts was set up by his wife Mrunalini, and she was a renowned dancer also. So the other awards and honors he received the Padma Bhushan and Padma Vibhushan also. And the Padma Vibhushan he received posthumously after his death. And a crater on the moon was renamed after him. So these were the awards and honors he received. And it is about the climate change. Other important article which comes under the GS3 portion. So the World Meteorological Organization announced that July 2019 broke the record of the hottest month. So basically this finding is from the analysis of new data. And this new data was carried out by World Meteorological Organization and Copernicus Climate Change Program. This Copernicus Climate Change Program was run by the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasts. So, and the previous hottest month ever recorded was July 2016. That too due to El Nino effect. But now it was broken by this year's July 2019, even though we don't have a El Nino effect. So basically, this July 2019, without having such El Nino effect, it struck the rise in temperature. So it is the important finding we have to consider about. And coming to the global scenario of climate change, it is the rise in temperature in several European countries. And next, it is the ice melting in Greenland, Arctic and European glaciers, the second scenario. And the third important scenario is the wildfires raised in Arctic region, which is contributing to the carbon dioxide, and also it is acting as a source of greenhouse gases leading to the global warming. Next important article is regarding forest and tree cover in India. Is the forest and tree cover in India? So the Ministry of Environment informed Parliament about the status of forest and tree cover in India. So basically this assessment of forest and tree cover is done by the Forest Survey of India, and the findings of this Forest Survey of India will be published in the India State of Forest Report. And the last report of India State of Forest Report was published in 2017. Okay, so according to this report, the total India's geographical area which is under forest and tree cover was 24.49%, is almost quarter of India's geographical area. So coming to the highest I mean, highest forest cover regarding the state which has the highest forest cover is Madhya Pradesh, and the union territory which has the highest forest cover is union territory of Lakshadweep. That is about 97%. Coming to the lowest, it is the Haryana and Punjab. It is the Haryana and Punjab with the lowest forest cover. So this is about the dynamics of forest cover. Next is about the Supreme Court regional benches. So in news, the Vice President of India, Venkaiah Naidu, has advocated the need to set up Supreme Court benches in different regions of the country. Okay. And the motto behind this, this concept is to bring the judicial system closer to people. And the regional bench of Supreme Court is being proposed at Chennai too. Coming to the Law Commission report 2019 and its recommendations are, it recommended a constitution bench should be set up in Delhi, and that constitution bench will look after with the dealing with constitutional and allied issues. And these regional benches proposed at Delhi, Chennai or Hyderabad, Kolkata and Mumbai, in the four directions of the country. And these regional benches or cassation benches will deal with all appellate cases arising out of the orders or judgments from the High Court. So the appellate judiciary will be exercised. I mean, that authority will be exercised from the regional benches which proposed to be set up. And the constitutional interpretation, the cases which has a constitutional interpretation will be dealt by the constitution bench set up in Delhi. So we have the arguments in favor, because we have in the need of the hour, we need these regional benches set up, because the litigants have to travel long distance and spend a huge amounts of money and energy in order to get the justice from the apex court. So we need these regional benches to address this issue and to sort out this issue. And other than this one, by setting up these benches outside Delhi, it will neither impact the unity and integrity, and also it will not undermine the importance of the Supreme Court. So this, coming to the way ahead, according to Article 130, no constitutional amendment is required to set up regional benches of Supreme Court. If there is a need of a constitutional amendment, then the Parliament should enact suitable legislation or constitutional amendment for this purpose. So this is about the Supreme Court regional benches. And next, a very famous Nehru Trophy boat race conducted by the Kerala government, and this coming Saturday. So popularly, this boat race is popularly known as Vallam Kali, which was held in Punnamada Lake near Alappuzha. And this boat race is usually organized by the Kerala government on every second Saturday of August, that is every year. And the event of competition of Chundan Vallams, that is snake boats, is most popular. And this race is also known as snake boat race. And it is Churulan Vallam, Irukkuthi Vallam, Odi Vallam, etc. are other categories of boats which participate in this competition. So basically, this Nehru Trophy boat race is organized by this Nehru Trophy Boat Race Society under the guidance of the district administration. So this is about the Nehru Trophy boat race. And next important article is regarding the nematodes. So according to the global analysis of nematodes, there are about 57 billion nematodes for every human beings on earth, you know. So what are these? Nematodes are roundworms basically, and they are very small in size. They vary 0.2 millimeter to a few meters. That's the size. What is the significance of these nematodes? They play a crucial role in the environment, as they are responsible for the production of nearly 19% of ammonia of the soil. The presence of ammonia will manifest the richness of the soil. So basically, they are also acts as important bioindicators of soil ecosystem health. That's the importance of nematodes. So the recent study came up with the findings that the total biomass of nematodes comes to around 300 million tons, which is nearly 80% of the combined weight of Earth's humans. And they are responsible for the emission of 2.2% carbon from soils. And basically, The highest abundance of nematodes are present at subarctic region, that is 66.5 degrees north and south latitudes. And the next after subarctic region, it is the tropical regions, in which our region we do have the abundance of nematodes presence. And next important article is regarding the OBC subcategorization commission. So basically the aim of this commission, before coming to the aim, let me explain you its composition. That is, it is a 5-member commission constituted under Article 340 of Constitution in 2017, that too with the approval of President. And this commission is headed by the former Chief Justice of Delhi High Court, who was retired, namely G. Rohini. So she is acting as the head of this commission. So the aim of this commission is to examine the extent of inequitable distribution of benefits of reservation among OBCs in central government jobs and educational institutions particularly, and that too with reference to OBCs included in central list. Basically, these OBCs identification will be on two phases. That is, OBCs included in central list and OBCs included in state list particularly. And that would be different from one state to another. So this commission will take the OBCs included in the central list to examine the benefits they are getting in the concept of government jobs and educational institutions. That is the first aim. And the second aim is to identify respective caste, subcaste, groups, communities into the central list of OBCs. So these are the two aims with which this OBC subcategorization commission was set up under Article 340 by President of India. And next importantly, it is the preconception and prenatal diagnostic technique. So basically, this PCPND Act was enacted in 1994 to stop female feticides and arrest declining sex ratio in India. So this act bans prenatal sex determination. It also bans counseling and conducting prenatal diagnostic techniques. What is the technique? Like, for example, it is the in vitro fertilization. Basically, this in vitro fertilization is an example of prenatal diagnostic technique. This act bans that technique. So these techniques usually conducted by the genetic counseling centers and genetic laboratory or genetic clinic usually engages into these activities, which are banned under this act. And this act also mandates the registration of genetic counseling centers, compulsory registration of all diagnostic laboratories, that is the genetic counseling centers, genetic laboratories and genetic clinics and ultrasound clinics. Finally, this act provides for the prohibition of sex selection before or after conception. So these are the set of articles in the today's current affairs analysis. Hope you enjoyed the video. All the best, students. Thank you very much.